His mother
wanted him to be a singer or a dancer, and he said, Mom, I can't sing and I can't dance.
Working in a shoe factory like his father also had little appeal.
Brockton was the shoe capital of the world. It made 12 million pairs of shoes a year.
But fortunately, Rocky Marciano, high school dropout, the oldest of six siblings born to Italian immigrants, could land a punch.
It had more force than a bullet fired from a pistol.
A talent that ultimately made the Brockton native the only undefeated heavyweight champion of the world.
He said, you know, I was a nobody, and in the ring I became a somebody.
He played baseball here.
Pulitzer Prize winning journalist and New York Times best-selling author Mike Stanton traces Rocky's rise in his book, Unbeaten, Rocky Marciano's fight for perfection in a crooked world.
He grows up in the 1920s. Rocky's a Depression kid. He comes of age during World War II, serves in the Army, and then fights his way to the top in that post-industrial America when everything is changing and boxing is becoming more corporatized because of television and also taken over by the mafia in a way that it hadn't been before.
Rocky grew up in this house on Brook Street and eventually moved down the street to this house on Dover Street. He was proud of his Brockton roots, and the city repaid the favor with tributes you can still see today.
Brockton made shoes, shoes made Brockton, and Brockton made Rocky Marciano.
This was his second home.
Growing up, Rocky spent many hours here at James Edgar Playground, playing his first love, baseball.
He had a tryout with the Chicago Cubs, and the supreme irony of his life is that the man with the greatest punch in heavyweight history didn't have a strong enough arm to make powerful throws to second base from the catcher's position.
So he turned to boxing at the late age of 24 and quickly rose to fame.
He was raw, he was crude. He went to New York and he got one of the most well-connected managers, but was also a puppet of the mob. So it was kind of this devil that he had to deal with to get to the top. And that's why the subtitle of my book is his fight for perfection in a crooked world.
In October 1951, the 28-year-old Rocky took out the boxing legend, Joe Louis.
He was elated because this set him on the path to the title, but then he cried because he had just, you know, ended the career of his hero. And they forged a bond later in life after they were both retired.
Nearly a year later, Rocky squared off with heavyweight champion Jersey Joe Walcott for the title.
Humphrey Bogart is there, Frank Sinatra is sitting with Rocky's pregnant wife, and things aren't looking good for Rocky, and there's a fear that the fix is in. They go into the 13th round, and Rocky throws one of the most famous punches in heavyweight history and to win the title.
His victory over Walcott ended 15 years of black heavyweight champions. Although reluctant, Rocky was dubbed the Great White Hope.
This is that era in America. We're in the 50s. I think he really bonded with black fighters in a way that, you know, I think goes back to his roots. One of the most interesting things I found researching this was the bond he forged with Muhammad Ali late in life.
Rocky remained champion until he hung up his gloves at the age of 32. No heavyweight champion has matched his record of 49-0.
So about that unlikely link with Muhammad Ali, Marciano did enter the ring once after retirement against Muhammad Ali, the greatest. In a film studio in 1969, they acted out every possible outcome of a real match between them. A computer analyzed opinions from professional boxing reporters, and the super fight, as it was called, was scripted and recorded. The result? Marciano by a KO in 57 seconds. One more thing. Author Mike Stanton will be doing a book signing at the Holyoke Barnes & Noble tomorrow afternoon. History says Bill Martin is not a thing of the past.
When I walk any street in this city, I can see the ghosts.